So this year, Joshua Pettigrew and myself, my name is Bradley Thompson, are heading up the leadership in the group, and we'll be inviting a bunch of different speakers out to speak on biblical worldview topics relating to many things. We'll open with a word of prayer. Close your eyes and get started. Dear Lord, thank you for this awesome evening. Thank you for everyone who's come to hear an important message, important topic, and we pray that your Holy Spirit would reside in this hall, in our hearts, and help us to think and train our minds to understand the world from the biblical perspective. Open our hearts and open our minds, and I pray for Dr. Andy McIntosh, as he speaks, that he would have clarity of thought, and thank you for his presence here tonight. In your name, bless this evening. Amen. So, an upcoming event that we have is Jen Smith, a really cool person who has been speaking at a bunch of churches in the Lower Mainland recently, will be coming to speak on what is SOGI 123, and what is that resource for our public schools in BC and Alberta. That will be coming up at the end of October, with the date to be determined still. And now, I would like to introduce our honored guest speaker. He became a Christian a year before heading off to Wales University, where he earned his Bachelor of Science and went on to earn a PhD at Leeds University in the UK and Mississippi, went on to earn a PhD at Cranfield University and a Doctorate of Science from Wales. He has been a professor at Leeds University in the UK and Mississippi University in the States, studying thermodynamics and combustion theory. Correct me if I say anything wrong.
Don't worry, it doesn't matter.
Okay, now he is retired, but he is still very active in presenting a biblical worldview in science and in debating different scientific theories. His 30 plus year long career in tandem with his pursuit of God has provided him with much wisdom and knowledge to share with us tonight. Let's welcome Dr. Andy McIntosh to the podium.
Well, it's a privilege to be here. Thank you very much. Could we just put the microphone more by ear?
Oh, yes.
Because I'm going to be maybe messing about with this machine. Thank you, Mr. Smith. That's very helpful. Is that all right with you?
Yeah.
So, thank you, Brad, very much for the kind welcome. And this is a very important issue to consider, a Christian worldview, and this Worldview Club, of course, is just the right organization to put on this meeting. Now, you may not yet be convinced on some of the issues that I'll be raising tonight, so I would not only ask you to listen carefully to what I have to say, not because it's me, but because we should weigh up everything carefully and see whether it's right or not, but also can I recommend some books which are on the table, not only my own materials, but the first thing I want to mention to you is John Ball is here, and his own book, The Divine Challenge, and his other book, God and Cosmos, are for sale on the bookstore. And I found this one very helpful, in particular, on matter, mind, math, and meaning, and I was telling him that I really appreciated that.
And who wrote that book?
John Ball,
yeah. He's here.
John, and see, where has he got to? Yeah, there he is, John. So, John has put a huge amount of effort into this book and the other book, and they are quite well known in England, in the evangelical world. Banner of Truth and other organizations do promote them, and I'm very pleased that they do, because he really gets, I don't want to embarrass him, but it really gets underneath this whole issue of creation evolution, and the real issue is naturalism, which is governing academia today, and trying to show that naturalism is just the antithesis to the biblical position, which is presupposition and declares that God is, and we must think in God's way. Well, there's more. There's a lot in this because it is the philosophical underpinning of the creation position. So I would recommend, if you believe in creation, and I think a good number of you do here tonight, you need to get hold of that book and try and digest it and get into the other book as well, God and Cosmos. On the actual issue of hearing, there is a number of pocket guides which are out there, and I really find these very helpful. The Answers in Genesis Christian Creation Group has done a great service here in sort of distilling the main arguments in terms of this book of the human body. And one of the section is on the human ear, and the hearing ear, it's called, by David Menton, and it's in there, but there's a lot of other sections, of course, to it as well. I find these books exceedingly useful for using at meetings that I speak at. Then there's other books here, some of which I've written. Genesis for Today, this is 18 Canadian rand. I've been in South Africa not long ago. I suppose I was thinking of that. Canadian dollars. This one, by the way, was $16. This one is $5. And this one, my own book, Genesis for Today, deals with why creation is important, deals with the theology of creation, and goes through the issues, creation and history, creation and marriage, creation and Genesis and science, Genesis and fundamentals. And there's a later chapter I added in the later editions, Genesis and the 21st century. That's $18. And then there's a verse by verse commentary on Genesis 1 to 11, which is quite a thin book. It won't take you long to go through it. You might like to use it as a study guide, $10 for that. Then there's another book which Stuart Burgess and myself have recently produced, just came out last year, which is full of pictures. So a lot of people like pictures to help them to sort of wade through the maths and wade through all the other stuff that's in here. But it's full of interesting facts as well. And it ends on the human body. And of course, there is a section, and I can find it, on the ear. So if you want to know more, and if you want to have something which will guide you on some of the things that I'm going to be talking about tonight concerning the ear, it's all in here. So if I can find it, I've got the eye, I've got the ear. Here we are. Here it is. The Wonder of Hearing is a double spread, two double spreads in this book. This book is obviously going to be more expensive. We don't apologize for that. This goes right up to $48, but it's a book you can leave on your coffee table, and maybe people come around and say, well, this is interesting, because they start flicking through it, they get absorbed by the pictures and everything. So it leads people into the subject. Then there are various DVDs that I've produced, including the talk that I'm going to present to you, The Wonder of Hearing. There's another one, Creation, So What's the Issue? That is the biblical talk, which might be of help to some of you. There's quite a number of other talks that I've done, DVDs are there, available. There's one that I do on the intricacies of flight. My background, let me just give these back to George. These should go back on the bookstore, all of them. My background is in mathematics and fluid dynamics, which was really what I did most of my research in. But I did quite a lot of work on acoustics, and I was dealing with acoustics and flames. Well, I hope you've got no flames in your ears, that there'll be something wrong with that. But I do know a little bit about the way sound waves work and the way they interact with barriers, which we're going to be considering tonight. But frankly, it is truly amazing. You don't need to know all the details of acoustics, I hope, to have access to what I'm going to be saying tonight. There is something truly amazing when we consider the works of God. Described in Job, here is Job being spoken to by the Lord through his word. He says, which does great things, this is speaking of God, which does great things past finding out, and wonders without number. That's what led to the title of our book, Stuart, myself and Brian Edwards, who was editing it. We wanted to give people a sense of wonder as to what God has done. Again in Job, it says, chapter 37, God thunders marvelously with his voice. Great things doeth he, which we cannot comprehend. And then God says in Job 37, consider the wondrous works of God. And I want to be considering the evidence for design along the lines of Romans, where it says in chapter 1, verse 20, that the invisible things of God are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. One of the problems that comes when people start trying to say that God used evolution is that they no longer have a sense of wonder as to what God has done, right? When you have this idea that you're trying to sort of marry two philosophies, which is really what's going on with the idea of saying that God used evolution, you're actually undermining the great wonder of the greatness of what God has done. We need to be thinking, in order to understand the wonder of hearing, we need to be thinking actually in engineering terms. I'm often spoken against in what I speak on, and people will say, oh, well, you just believe in the God of the gaps, don't you? Given enough time, we'll be able to find out how this works from an evolutionary point of view. But actually, that's wrong. It is not what we don't know which tells us that there is a God who has made hearing. It's what we do know. Every layer of the onion, as it were, shows us the wonder of what God has done. So the inference is always to the best explanation for design, or in the design argument. When you actually consider the understanding hearing, we're not going to say go for some tortuous explanation. We're going to go for the more obvious explanation, which is that there is design in the ears that we have. And I'm going to show you this stage by stage. But I need to set the scene and show you first, what is sound? We need to actually understand what sound is first. Hopefully I won't lose you all as I put up one or two figures which might just make it accessible to you, but others it might make it more difficult. I hope it won't. But then I'm going to consider how do we hear, and running through this presentation tonight is the principle of irreducible complexity, which means that nothing will work unless everything works. That's a layman's definition of irreducible complexity. Michael Behe coined that term some years ago when he was writing his book, Darwin's Black Box. He's from Lehigh University in Pennsylvania. But I think it's a very good principle to grasp. The principle is not complexity. Many people who take an evolutionary view will say, oh, you're just saying it's too complex, give them enough time, we'll develop it. No. They completely misunderstood the argument. The argument is that, it's usually an engineer who understands this, and you need to be looking at the biology from an engineering perspective. Many biologists miss it, not all, some do get it, because some really do cross the discipline barriers, and it's good when they cross the discipline barriers. And I myself try to cross over into the biology barrier, the biology area, in order for me to learn how they're thinking. And it's at the barrier, or at the joining between biology and engineering, that you suddenly grasp what's going on with hearing, and of course within many other aspects of the way that we are made. It's when you see that it's not a matter of gradual development that something will get to where it is now. That actually you can't do that. There is a massive chasm between this creature or that principle and another which you're trying to get to. That there is no bridge to go from one to the other. You've got to have everything working to make it be an advantage. So that's running through the talk. I'm not doing a separate section on it. Now, what is sound? Sound is when you have bouncing molecules. Usually, of course, it's in air, but you could technically have sound going through other gases, but the only minor problem would be that you wouldn't be able to breathe and you'd be dead, so it's not worth going down that line. But for us, it's nitrogen primarily and oxygen. If you're not familiar with the physics of air, think of it like lots of billiard balls bouncing together and causing a wave going through the air. To be frank, it's not quite that, but you know, that'll just get the idea over to you. You've got a wave in existing material. Gas is actually hugely full of molecules. You might not think so, you can't see them, but they're there. We've got them here at the moment. And if you took the air out of this room, you won't be able to hear. You'd be dead, as I said earlier, so that's not worth going down that line. But that's what happens with sound. Now, sound has, if you're not familiar with frequency, many of you are not because you come from a more humanities background, musical background, you might be familiar with the term pitch, right? Which is why I put the keyboard down below, because some of you are familiar with piano keyboards, you know what a piano looks like. And so 27 or so cycles per second is the G right down there. And when you go right up here, whatever that is, C, the C right at the top of the piano, that's just over 4,000 cycles per second. A chap called Hertz, H-E-R-T, the Americans say C, do the Canadians say C or Z?
Z.
Okay, you're a Z fan. Okay, perhaps I've got to change, just because I crossed the border today, I got to now think in terms of Zs. Okay, so H-Z means Hertz, stands for Hertz, and he's a chap who just gave his name, obviously got his name in lights because he invented the idea of cycles per second. Somebody had to do it, needed. Okay, so the sound that we hear goes from about that which we can hear lowest, is somewhere in the region of 20 cycles per second, goes all the way up to, when you're born, 20,000 cycles per second. When you're getting a bit old, like in your teens, you're beginning to lose it. Sorry, teenagers, you are actually, some of you, going to lose it. You'll particularly lose it if you have all these earbuds in, playing loud music, you'll lose it even faster, okay? Now, when you're getting really old like me, I can't hear my wife across the table, and I'm saying, please, what did you say? She said, do the washing up, right? Selective hearing may be involved here, but we actually do lose it a lot more later on at the high frequency. So sadly, some of us begin to lose it right down here. Speech lies roughly in this region. So we're talking here about the pitch of sound. Sound also has an amplitude, which means how much it's going in and out, right? It's not really sideways movement, as those graphs seem to be indicating. It's actually going like this. The pressure's going up, then it's going down again. And it's how much it goes up and down, right? So you're talking about the scale of the vibration. The sound is always traveling at roughly 600 miles an hour. So in a room like this, you're hearing me immediately, basically. You know full well that when you see lightning on the Cascades or whichever mountains you're looking at, you know, I'm sure that happens. You'll see the lightning and you'll only hear it quite a lot later because light travels at a much faster speed. So that gets the idea of amplitude. How do you measure amplitude? Well, it's these things called pascals, which I won't go into all the detail. If you're an engineer here, you might be familiar with newtons, and newtons per meter squared is the unit of pressure. Pressure is to do with force per unit area, but don't worry too much about the figures. There'll be a test afterwards, but you could look over somebody else's shoulder. No, there won't be, I'm just pulling your leg. But having a few ideas just to make it accessible might just help you here. So rather than dealing with millionths of a pascal, which is what we got here, sorry, thousandths of a pascal, millipascals, what we tend to do is not deal with those units. We tend to deal, and I'm not going to explain this in detail, we tend to deal with a logarithmic scale called decibels, right? And speech is normally in the region of about 40 to 60 decibels. But you only need to go up to about 100 decibels and it's getting too loud for you. And certainly if you go to 120 decibels, you're in the realm of a pounding rock concert, right? And I say you do need to be careful about commenting on the rights and wrongs of the type of music that you might not, so you'll have to choose yourself and work that one out. But in terms of the noise level, you do need to be exceedingly careful. A jet engine at 100 meters is about 128 decibels, and 130, you're beginning to feel pain, right? So we do need to have ear protectors. So I would suggest to you that just keeping that in mind will be helpful to you as you now go with me into this section, which is the main section. How do we hear? Well, we hear using these things. Now, some people actually only have one. I've seen people with that, they have a genetic malfunction which has caused the side of their face not to develop properly, and they'll have a slanting mouth as a result. They cope, but they won't be able to hear where the sound comes from. The fact we've got two ears gives us an understanding generally as to where sound comes from. Some creatures do it far better than us. Bird ears are particularly attuned to hearing exceedingly well. Owls, for instance, hunt using two ears which are not quite symmetrical, and they get a complete view, sort of sound view, of the area that they're hunting at night. And it's not their vision that homes in on the vole or the mouse that they're going to get, it's their hearing. They usually get it right. It's really quite remarkable seeing owls do that. We have, therefore, the outer ear, the middle ear, and the inner ear. We're going to look at them in turn. And we're going to consider, first of all, this outer ear that I've just referred to, then we're going to look at the middle and the inner ear, and you are quite at liberty, if you wish, to go, wow. Or you could even say hallelujah if you really wish. But, you know, I want you to see the wonder of hearing. We're going to be, at the moment, thinking about human hearing. But there'll come a point where I'll be saying to you, this is true of all mammals. And the heart of the talk is really saying, how did mammalian hearing, supposedly by the evolutionary thinking, come from the hearing of reptiles, which is very different. So the outer ear, you've got two located on either side of the head, and the ear remarkably funnels the sound into the ear canal. Only in the last few years have people begun to realize that the shape of the ear is not just any old shape. Now, you might have wondered that. You think, why, you know, have we got ears shaped quite like this? Well, if you put your hand over the back of your ear, you'll suddenly notice that the hearing changes. You might like to do that just at this moment. You notice that you're beginning to hear in a somewhat different way. You're hearing other noises as well, and it's not so clear in the human speech range because you're magnifying other sounds as well. If you take your hands away, suddenly it becomes clear. Why? Because the ear, the outer part of the ear, particularly encourages those frequencies 1 to about 6 or 7, 8,000 cycles per second, where speech is, right? So we use a whole range of frequencies as we're speaking. When we say right, that is a very high frequency sound combined with the vowels R, right, which are low notes, probably right down to the few hundred cycles per second, okay? So speech is composed of a whole range of frequencies, and particularly this and all these sorts of sounds are all very high frequency sounds. And so the ear is designed, I would suggest to you, almost immediately from the word go, we see that human hearing is attuned to speech, right? We're designed to speak to one another. By the way, that means not looking down here at my phone all the time, right? So sometimes society could learn from the fact that we're designed to talk. Yes, talk and listen to one another is actually not a bad idea. Now, let me tell you something else. We're going to now talk about the ear canal, which is the 2 centimeter roughly long tube, which runs from the end of this bit, right, inside the head. It's roughly 2 centimeters. And it's good job that it's not wider or as wide as your little finger, because you might damage the eardrum inside. So it's not just any old hole either. And it's about 2 centimeters long. For us to understand why that's important, I need to talk to you about something else with sound, and that is resonance. When something resonates, it means that it's vibrating in sympathy with something else. I don't think I've got a glass of water, or I'm not asking necessarily for water at this point, but if I had a glass or a bottle and I flicked the top of the bottle, it might make a note, okay? Because that bottle would have a particular vibration which is characteristic of the shape of the bottle. More water in and it would change the notes, okay? So everything has a natural frequency. And if I hit this, this will have some sort of vibration. This will have another vibration. So if somebody was playing some low frequency, loud music in this room with lots of drums, this might start shaking as well, in sympathy, right? We call that resonance, okay? Now, when you've got a bottle, as I've just mentioned, but a glass like that, with a sound which is quite loud, just, or quite a large amplitude, just at the right frequency, it might break. The famous Tacoma Narrow Bridge, close to Seattle, it's in that region somewhere. The Tacoma Narrows, actually, it broke and it snapped because somebody hadn't done their homework properly on the wind effect on that bridge, which picked up the natural frequency of the bridge. And because the wind was still driving that vibration, it went more and more until eventually it collapsed. And I always want to know what happened to that car on the bridge. Nobody showed me the next bit, but I hope it didn't drop into the Tacoma Narrows. A flute, a musical instrument, operates in the same way. You blow over the hole and blow at that hole, which is open, of course, and you cause a vibration to the next point where the flute is open. You set up a wave in the flute. So the flute is vibrating at that particular frequency naturally. Why do I say this? Because as I said, we have a tube which is 2 centimeters long. We do the mathematics on that. And we find, amazingly, that it vibrates, guess what, naturally at about 4,000 cycles per second, which is right bang in the middle of the human speech region. It is no accident, I would suggest to you. Approximately 2 centimeters, if you do the mathematics, which is at the top left on the screen, those of you who like doing the equations, you can see it. I'm not going to go into the detail there. If you get the physics of a quarter wave, which is what you've got, this is a quarter of a wave because it will take 4 times that to come back to where it was before. It's open at this end, it's closed effectively at the eardrum. So it sets up, when you put that into the equation for speed of sound, frequency and wavelength, you get an equation C equals 4FL, outcomes L, or you put in the L as 2 centimeters, and out comes the frequency of approximately 4,000 cycles per second. You need the speed of sound, which is about 320 meters per second. That's not too hard a calculation to do, but it really is quite remarkable that our ears are just the right shape, just the right length of ear canal, to tune in, as it were, to focus in on human speech. It doesn't mean we can't hear other sounds. It means that we naturally amplify human speech. Amazingly, of course, now I'm going to move to other mammals. So at this point on, or just after this point, I'll be talking about mammals in general. But just so you see that human speech or human ears are different to cat's ears. A cat's ear has an ear canal which actually has a right angle bend. And the ear of a dog, both the outer part of the ear and the inner part, or the inner part of the TWU of a dog and a cat is very different. You actually get another bit which, for the ear of a dog, it actually turns at a right angle again. And it's well known that dogs hear up to about a frequency of 40,000 cycles per second. So that means that you can have a dog whistle, which we can't hear, but the dog does. Cats can hear right up to 60,000 cycles per second. Now, if there's any cat lovers here, forgive me, I'm going to make a remark, because I'm not that favorable to cats. That's not my favorite animal, because I somehow don't hit it off with cats. Okay, but I rather like birds, right? And I like birds being in my garden, and there were some cats recently which went and nabbed one of them, which I wasn't very fond of. And so we have cat scarers in our garden because we like to look at the birds, the goldfinches and all the other creatures that we have. I like to see them. I love to see the hummingbirds. I've seen some in Seattle. Anyway, so I like birds. So we set up cat scarers in our garden, and the cat scarers, of course, are going right up to 60,000 cycles per second. And would you believe it, they come in and they sit on the cat scarers. A lot. But some people come in, young people, who can hear the bottom part of the cat scarers, and they say, why have you got those noisy machines in your garden? And they say, we can't hear them. Of course we can't, but they can. So there we go. So there are the creatures which can hear in a much higher frequency, but essentially they have the same system. Although I'm showing you a picture now of a human ear, all that follows is all to do with mammals, right? And I'm now going to home in on mammalian hearing, and that gets really interesting. Because did you know that as the sound comes in, it hits this eardrum, which vibrates, not because of any drumstick behind it, which I'm going to start talking about, but it vibrates naturally as a result of the sound that I'm speaking now. Your eardrum is doing it. It's a very small vibration, but it's vibrating. And behind it, would you believe it, are three little bones which are so important. They are called the ossicle bones. And as the tympanic membrane, which is the eardrum, vibrates, it actually pushes pushes a hammer behind the eardrum, and it pushes an anvil, which is the next bone, and a stirrup. There is a technical term for each of these bones. The first one is the malleus, the next one is the incus, and then the third one is technically called the stapes, right? And these three bones start vibrating and amplifying the very small vibration of the eardrum and making it a much larger vibration of the stirrup. So you can imagine, if you've got any knowledge of engineering here, to actually have this sophisticated system of three little bones amplifying the signal is not something which is going to happen without a cleverness of design behind those bones. You're not going to get that without a thoughtful means of making sure that those bones actually move against each other, because what happens is that the hammer moves, or the malleus moves like this and pushes against the anvil, right? So it's this sort of motion. I'll show you a video of it in a moment. And then it pushes against the stapes, or the stirrup, because it looks like the stirrup of a horse, and that acts like a piston, because we're moving from air into, guess what, liquid. And this is the whole reason for this system. Reptiles don't have it. They don't have this amplification system. Why do we need an amplification system? Because a mammal's hearing system is meant to listen to high frequency sound. And high frequency sound is not something which amplifies easily, right? You actually need a system in order to be able to pick up these high frequencies. That's why it is there. And get this, these three bones called the ossicles are the only bones, Juliet, I forgot to get them out. There's a little red compartment in the blue bag under my coat. And there's a little red bag underneath. I'm going to show you what these three bones look like. Here we are. Juliet's going to pass around, my wife here's Juliet, she's going to pass around these ossicle bones. They're the only bones which do not grow in the human body. Get that? They're the same size just before you were born as a baby, and they're the only bones which stay the same size when you die at 100 or 91 or whenever you do die, right? Okay? Those bones do not grow. Now, the evolutionist actually makes a claim here, and we need to be fair to those who think differently on this issue. There are those who think that these bones came from the jaw of a reptile. We should not laugh at that, right? This is a serious proposition of the evolutionist. So I'm not mocking when I now deal with this issue. They say that the rear part of the lower jaw, because the jaw is two or three bones in a reptile, and it's not in a mammal, and the rear part of the upper jaw moved and became the malleus, the incus, respectively, with a shortened stapes, because a reptile just simply has a long stapes, right? But there are big problems with that proposition. The first problem is that the shape is exceedingly important to make this system work. The second problem is that these bones that we have don't grow, but the bones of reptile jaws, have you looked in a crocodile's jaw recently? I'm not sure I'd recommend it, but if you were, you would see that it's huge. But it started off as a tiny little embryo like this. So those jaw bones are constantly growing. There is no known evidence which shows that has actually happened. Remember, science must be based on evidence, not on conjecture. I gave this talk once at another university in South Africa. The person said, please keep to the science. And I said, well, which part of the science are you referring to that you don't like? Or, you know, tell me what it is in terms of the science which you're saying is I haven't dealt with. And he just closed the lid of his computer, Walter, didn't even engage. And this is not useful. If we're going to actually present the other side, we need to present carefully the evidence. I'm seeking to present evidence which actually shows that this is not evolution that has taken place. This is actually great evidence of design. This is a penny in England. I'm not sure whether you're familiar with it, but you know, it's the smallest part of money that we can have, and it's slightly larger than an American dime, is it? Oh, I get confused. Yes, it is larger than an American dime. I mean, this is the proper money, all the rest is the... I can't say that now in Canada, that can I? But now, these bones are really quite remarkable, and I'm going to show you how they work in a video. Just before I come to the cochlea, let me just show you this, which helps to understand what these bones are doing. This is a very useful video. Now you can see the movement of the malleus, the incus, and the stapes. And it's pushing against a membrane here, behind which there is liquid. And so because it's liquid, please note that there is another membrane here, which is called the circular window, which pushes out while this one pushes in. Now that's a very important matter. If you get a bicycle pump full of air, put your finger over the end, would you be able to push the handle down? Think for a moment, some of you will have done this. Put your hand over the end of the bicycle pump. Can you push the handle down? Some of you shake your hands. Is that true of all of you? Are you all thinking that you can't push the handle down? Think for a moment. Can you push that? You can push it down a bit. You can. Maybe a centimetre or two. Maybe 2 or 3 centimetres. Because air, understand this, is compressible. You can push against it. In fact, as you push against it, the bicycle pump heats up because you're putting energy into the air, right? That's what happens. However, If you now push the handle down, put the end into a bucket of water, bring up the water, put your finger over the end, forget you've got a water pistol, we're not playing games, right? And you now put your finger over the end again, would you be able, supposing all the valves are working properly, would you be able to push the handle down? The answer is what? You're all sort of, you're hedging your bets here, because you don't want to be regarded as foolish. I'm not trying to make you feel foolish, I'm just trying to get you to think. The answer is, of course, you would not be able to push the handle down, because liquid is essentially incompressible. You cannot compress liquid. So when I showed you that film there, I didn't explain all the things there. Let me just show you again. This one, right? Can you see the round window, this one down below? That's the one, this is the one that the stirrup is pushing in on, but because that's pushing in, it needs another window, this one, to vibrate in sympathy the other way, for the liquid has to have somewhere to go. So now, as we consider the inner ear, which is now what we're considering, I want you to understand that the cochlea is full of liquid. It's very small, but it looks like a snail or looks like a cockle shell. And so if we open it out in our minds, we can perhaps understand a bit more as to what's going on. It's full of liquid. And that window that I've just showed you, which is actually relieving the pressure of the liquid, is hugely important. It's the mark of design. And those three little bones and this little circular window should already be causing us to say, wow, there is something truly remarkable here. But this is just on the foothills of the greatness of what God has done in the design of the ear. If we think of it like a mountain showing the glory of God, this is just the foothills of his majesty in creation, because I'm now going to show you something utterly amazing. Did you know that inside the ear, the inner ear, there is a membrane which is vibrating in the liquid, and it's called the basilar membrane, right? The basilar membrane. And it vibrates as this set of bones is vibrating. You say, well, why is it doing that? I'll tell you why. We're now going to open up that spiral cochlea, and we're going to open it up as though it was all flattened out, okay? And we see that it generally is tapering to the end. Big in the middle, and then tapering at the end. It's rather like an xylophone. And there is another wow factor, get ready to say it. Because supposing the vibration is coming in at one frequency, let's say 440 cycles per second, which for a musician here, we all know is the note A above middle C. So we might say, ah, right, as the orchestra is tuning up for a performance, they all play the A above C, la. Well, that means that at one location in the basilar membrane, it begins to vibrate at that location, which is just the location for the natural resonance, which I mentioned earlier, of the basilar membrane to be caused to vibrate, right? It vibrates just at that point. Bit like an xylophone, which has wider notes at the low end and shorter notes at the top end. Come on, you've all played with xylophones, with your grandkids or with your kids, or maybe you played just on your own and you've done twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. And all you need is the eight notes in C to do that, okay? So, the top one is smaller than the bottom one, isn't it? And they vibrate naturally at those frequencies. So when you hit them, they vibrate at that note. Well, that's what this passive membrane is doing. So that if we now play C, right, or some lower note, then a different location vibrates. In other words, get this, guys, if you're an engineer, and some of you may be, this is an automatic frequency analyzer. That's a technical term, I know, but I'll explain it. It immediately splits the sound into its component frequencies, and we all go, this is just, frankly, amazing. Because it's not done digitally. Most sound engineers today would do this digitally. They'd listen to a bit of the signal and they'd split it up. It might take, you know, it might only be a millisecond of the signal. They'd say, yes, this is composed of all these frequencies. But there would be a delay. Not with the ear. It's done immediately. There is no time delay. Because an analog system is entirely mechanical, and that's what's going on with the ear. We haven't even got to the, we're only on the middle ground. We've got to climb Everest yet to show you the immensity of what God's done. But even this is amazing, right? It's like a little gremlin is playing in your ear. So you are hearing my voice, which of course is composed of lots of frequencies. I mentioned to you that all these other consonants are very high frequency sounds. And all the other vowels are low frequency. So as I'm speaking, I've actually got the whole range of the frequencies and you are hearing it. Because you've got a little gremlin playing in both ears the appropriate frequencies, which, if you like, simulate's not the right word, but emulate the voice that is causing those sounds. Do you get me? So it's absolutely incredible because it's got to be split into frequencies because of something going to happen next, right? And this is just truly amazing. When I began to realize this, I was, you know, I felt like just going out and saying, look, this is amazing, right? Just this bit is amazing. So we're now going to play a little video clip so that I can get my breath back and you can understand a bit more about what hearing is. So hear this with me.
Hopping that import, let's look at the basal membrane, and now see what happens when we play individual tones. Now a chord.
So it's like an excitement.
Finally, something really complex. It's
music. So everything starts going. Amazing, there's something more, even more amazing to come. Because we've split now the sound that's coming in into its component frequencies. Does anybody not understand that phrase in the light of what I've been saying? Have you grasped it, right? So if you're an engineer here, the rest of you can close your ears off to this bit. What you're really doing, you can listen if you want, what you're really doing is you're going from the time plane, the signal is naturally in the time plane, right? It's changing with time. You're going from the time plane into what we call the frequency plane. And that is brilliant engineering. If you're an acoustic engineer, that's exactly what an acoustic engineer always wants to do. He wants to analyze the sound. If he's got a loud noise of an RB211 engine, the best engines, of course, are over there. Nothing to do with General Electric, South of us. Okay, Boeing, but we leave them behind. But when you actually analyze the sound of these engines, right, he wants to reduce the noise, right? You've heard all the noise of aircraft engines, if you heard them 30 years ago, you want to reduce the noise. So people have been looking at the noise of RB211s, RB199s, and all the big engines, like Rolls-Royce Trent engine, okay, and they thought, how can we reduce it? Well, they've had to analyze analyze the sound and say, can we reduce it to this frequency and the others and all the rest of it, okay? So now, basically, when an aircraft comes into land, you're hearing much more the noise of the airframe rather than the noise of the engines. Still noisy, but at least you reduce the engine noise. So engineers think in terms of pitch and frequency, right? They don't really think in terms of, well, that was a loud noise. You've got to be very specific. And this is what the ear does. It actually is a very specific system for taking the sound coming in and splitting it into frequency. But as you got the implication there from that last little video, we are hugely over-designed. If in fact we were coming from some ape-like creature where the male was saying to his female, ooh, I want my dinner, you know, but he doesn't need to communicate with all these other frequencies available to him. Grunts, right, don't require the sophistication of this type of listening instrument called the ear. So I'm back a bit talking now about humans. So there is something wonderful in the human ear, which is what I would call over-design. And over-design, as Stuart Burgess has often written on this point in his book, I'm not sure whether we got it, Hallmarks of Design. Over-design is evidence for a mind behind it. And it's evidence for beauty, right? Now, I could talk about the eye. I'm not an expert on the eye, but the eye is able to see color, right? Now, it's a bit like that with sound. The color of sound, shall I tell you how the color, the equivalent of color is in sound? It's when you can listen to harmony, harmonics, right? Now I'm going to talk to you about harmony in sound. We have the ability to hear far more than just one sound at one frequency. Let me illustrate this by cheating a bit because I've used the Sonic Visualizer program in order to make the point. What I've got here is a piano keyboard that's a bit small down there, okay? And you're going to see in a moment different sounds amplified. This is the amount of amplification here against a particular note. So we're going to see a chord played, as it were, on your basilar membrane. We'll see this operating in a moment here, okay? So the basilar membrane. Right, you'll notice that this is a pure sound, but it's not quite pure because there was a lot of other frequencies up here, which it was still exciting. It's very difficult to get a pure sound at one frequency. But now I'm going to play some music. And what I'm simulating is the vibration of your basilar membrane. So what you're seeing on the screen is a bit like what the basilar membrane is doing. When we hear the music of cellos, when we hear the music of a double bass, when we hear the music of violins, all playing notes related to each other, they excite other notes at high frequencies, which we call harmonics. And our ears, because they have this ability to hear very high frequency, means that we hear beauty. Oh, it's not playing. So this is a lovely piece which I rather like. And this is the main note that you're hearing. Right? But you're hearing all these other notes here, which are the harmonics, which depend on the instrument that's playing the main note. It's violins, but it's also cellos and double bass, because it's mainly stringed instruments that are playing this piece. But if you were to have an oboe, it would have a different characteristic, okay? So the characteristic, or if you like, the color of the sound, is what gives us beauty in music. And our ears, back to human ears, are particularly attuned to hearing the sounds and the harmony. And many of us can actually not only hear it in our minds, but actually join in with our own voices, which is really something which typifies the human hearing. You see, other creatures do have the ability to, well, I'll put appreciate in quotes, music. And there are other mammals. I'm going to illustrate with a dog, which is a dog of Stuart Burgess's daughter, Naomi, who's not been too well, and so she was given this chihuahua, right? Not quite sure why she wanted a chihuahua, but she did. She likes to cuddle them, I guess. But this chihuahua starts doing something as Naomi plays the piano. So dogs sort of appreciate the music. But if you notice, that chihuahua is not singing in tune. That is the difference. It may have some sort of appreciation, but it's not quite able to join in the song and sing in tune, which is, of course, what humans can do. I actually have another parallel talk, which I'm going to develop. I still haven't finished it, which is on the voice. Mm-hmm. There is a connection here between hearing and the voice, which is unique to humans. So I'm almost through, but you'll notice that we started off with these little bones, or at least we started off out here. Then we have the little bones vibrating. They hit the oval window, the round window vibrates in sympathy. We're not showing on this particular video the basilar membrane, but it vibrates at different locations depending what frequencies are coming in, which is what these stars are doing. And finally, it eventually causes those sounds to get to the brain. Now that's the next bit that I want to draw your attention to. High frequency is out here, and it's the outer part of the cochlea, and it's this bit which sadly tends to go, particularly in old age. We begin to really lose that. You even lose it, as I said, even in the teenage years, particularly if you misuse your ears. Then this is the lower frequencies in there. Now, we're going to slice through the cochlea, right? The cochlea is tiny, absolutely wee, sort of only a millimeter or so. And now we slice through the cochlea, and we notice that there's not just two canals, which the earlier video, I think, comment showed you. You've got the tympanic canal, down which the oval window vibrates, and it sends it down. The tympanic canal comes up, back up the vestibular canal, pushes out the round window. But we've got a third canal, which is the cochlear duct. Now this is where it gets hugely interesting. We're almost at the top of the mountain of God's majesty demonstrated in the design of the ear. Because now you're going to not only go, wow, you're going to go, this is just incredible. Because remember, we've moved from the vibration in air to the vibration of three little bones mechanically, right? And the mechanical shape was very important, the ligaments holding them. I said that the idea that it could come from a reptile jaw is frankly not fitting the evidence at all, right? Then there's the vibration of sloshing liquid, the tympanic membrane, splitting it into its component frequencies. But now we're actually going to look at one frequency. How does this frequency get to the brain? That's what we're looking at now. And what an Italian investigator found about 50 years ago was the name he gave to it, of course, is his own name, the organ of Corti, which runs alongside the basilar membrane. So as the basilar membrane is vibrating, the organ of Corti is pushed around as well. And what's happening in the organ of Corti is frankly absolutely incredible. Because now I'm going to tell you that in this cochlear duct, this is full of an electrolyte. It's full of charged particles in a fluid. It's a bit like water, but it's not really water, okay? It's a bit like what's in your car battery, right? Don't go around faffing about with your car battery afterwards, because that wouldn't be a good idea. But your car battery is full of ions, I-O-N-S, right? And it's got charged particles in it. Now, that's very important, that just this one part of the ear canal, the ear, the inner ear, has charged particles flowing in it. And those charged particles are now going to do something utterly extraordinary. Because the organ of quality has tiny little hairs which are poking into this fluid. And these hairs are so small that you could get 72 of them in the width of a human hair. So they are amazing because they come in pairs. So I won't take a hair off my head if you don't mind to demonstrate, because I haven't got a lot. But God does know how many I've got, by the way. But you could get 72 of them in the width of a human hair. So that's very, very small. Wouldn't you agree, right? But now I'm going to get even smaller. Did you know that these hairs come in pairs? They're called stereocilia. And as they vibrate and get pushed over, because the basilar membrane is nearby pushing them, right? The hairs do this. They bend over, and would you believe it, get ready for a real wow factor, there is a mechanical spring, literally a mechanical spring, which is attached to the tip of one hair, and the other end is attached literally to a trap door at the other hair. And as they bend over, the ions go one by one down the hair and excite a special nerve called the spiral ganglion nerve. So we all go,
hallelujah, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah, glory to God.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. This is showing the wonder and the peak, really, of what's going on in the human ear, but also, of course, this is true of all mammals. All mammals have got this. Now, I've been saying that this is at one frequency. I'll come away from the microphone for this bit, but because I want to demonstrate. So, at one frequency, at the low frequency, you've got a spiral ganglion which takes its particular signal. Remember, it's a chemical energy going down, right? It's chemical energy which has actually caused the ions to go down the hair. So we move from mechanical motion to chemical energy going down the hair, and it's exciting an electrical signal, right? Which is due to the nerves down here. And 20,000 cycles per second has its spiral ganglion, 19,900 and whatever it is, right, has its particular spiral ganglion. And if we go right down here, we've got 20 cycles per second, 21 cycles per second, 22, 23, 24, 25, and all the way back up to 20,000, except that at 20,000, maybe the resolution doesn't need to be quite up down to one cycle per second. Nobody who's musical will be able to tell the difference between 10,000 and 10,003. Even if they're highly musical, they won't actually work it out. But down at the low frequency, actually you can tell the difference much more readily. It's a sort of logarithmic effect. So we've got a set of spiral ganglion nerves which take the signal to the brain at essentially every frequency. Now we come to the last bit. Because we got this signal at a particular frequency, how does it end up in the brain? Well, what happens is that these sets of frequencies are excited, and the nerves appropriate to that frequency are excited. They are sent to the brain, either to the left side, which is the logical side, or if it's music, it goes to the right side of the brain. And actually, sometimes it has been found when people have had probes into the way the brain is working, they've seen that the signal bounces from one side of the brain to the other. In other words, there is a sorting mechanism going on in the brain. It's going across the brain in very, very fast indeed, and analyzing the signal and saying, yeah, that's to do with speech, that's to do with information, that ends up being in the left side of the brain. But if it's musical, it ends up being in the right side of the brain. So if you're remembering tunes, it's all in the right side of the brain. And if you're listening to the voice, perhaps, of someone you really appreciate, like the lady you're courting or the man that you're courting. Oh, you know, the voice perhaps excites both sides of the brain, who knows, if it's the voice of your well-beloved. So here are the amazing things going on in the way we hear. Two last things to say, and that's this. Your ear also has a balance system in the inner ear. You probably all know that there are three semicircular canals which are doing something rather similar to the inner ear, the cochlea, but instead of doing it for sound, they're doing it for balance. So there is a mechanism to tell me that I'm spinning round, okay, and that's dealing, that's because there's fluid in this semicircular canal which is exciting stereocilia, which is again sending a signal to my brain that I'm spinning round. If I'm swaying that way, there's another semicircular canal which controls that. And if I'm swaying like this, there's a semicircular canal which is controlling that motion, or at least indicating what I'm doing, right? And sending a signal to the brain to say, stay upright, guys, don't tip right over, otherwise you'll fall, right? Suppose you're at the top of the Leaning Tower of Pisa, you don't want to end up on the ground, okay? So you're sort of, you've got a sense mechanism, in other words. Now, why is this important? When people looked at creatures like Lucy and others, which are supposed to be halfway creatures between man, not an ape, be fair to the evolutionist position, the evolutionist says that there is a common ancestor between man and apes to something ape-like. So they will argue that this is a halfway house leading to man. But this is interesting. Fred Spohr has done CAT scans of the inner ear region of some of these skulls, the proposals that these skulls were halfway creatures. These show that the semicircular canals, which determine balance and ability to walk upright, resemble those of the extant, that's the ones that we have today, great apes. So the extinct creatures look like creatures that we have today, which we would call apes. Now, how did they do it? It's all to do with the one which is horizontal, this one, right? People never tell you this on CNN or on the equivalent in Canada or whatever it is, you know, the general news programs. BBC would be the equivalent in England. They never tell you that when you look at the skulls, you usually have in these so-called half skulls, half human, half ape, they don't tell you that generally the semicircular canals are still visible. And of course, for an ape, that semicircular canal, particularly this horizontal one, is horizontal when the ape is like this, because it's not used to walking vertically. Apes and primates generally walk like that. They do walk on two legs, that's true, and I won't go into detail, but their knees actually are different, but we won't go into that now. But the horizontal canal is horizontal when it's like that, not when they're like that. So you can tell immediately when you've got a human skull. Because if you were to look at my skull, I'm no ape, and I tell you that now, but I'm not connected to the ape kind. I'm created in the image of God, and all of you are as well, yeah. And your semicircular canals are horizontal when you are standing to the attention, vertical, right? And that determines the difference between skulls. They never tell you this when they line up the supposed progression of ape-like skulls leading to humans, and then they'll say some of them led to apes. Let me tell you one last thing, that was the next to last thing. I want to tell you, I won't speak directly on the human irreducible complexity, but I will just comment on this. Reptile ears are reckoned to have evolved into the ears of mammals. This is the ear of a mammal, this is the ear of a reptile. You'll notice, and it's quite true, that the lower part of the jaw is three bones. And it's reckoned that this back part, right, has become the malleus, and the back part of the upper jaw, the quadrate, has become the incus. They don't, of course, tell you how the stapes shortened and became into the right position. I've dealt with that earlier. But now I just want to comment on this because I'm going to do it through a quote from Richard Dawkins from his book, The Greatest Show on Earth. And he says, in a footnote, the lower jaw, a single bone in mammals, the reptilian lower jaw is more complicated. Thereby hangs a fascinating tale that I reluctantly omitted from this book. In an amazing feat of evolutionary legerdemain, the smaller bones of the reptilian jaw were co-opted into the mammalian ear, where they constitute an exquisitely delicate bridge to transport sound from the eardrum to the inner ear. Legerdemain. It means, according to, if you pick up the Webster's Dictionary or Oxford Dictionary, it will say something like sleight of hand. A synonym for that would be artfulness, chicanery, conjuring, craftiness, cunning, deceit, deception, hocus pocus. Interestingly, a gentleman called Brian Cox, who lectures on these subjects in our country, said this.
Yes, continued. Around 210 million years ago, the first mammals evolved. And unlike our friends the reptiles here, mammals have a jaw that's made of only one bone. A reptile's jaw is made of several bones fused together. So that freed up two bones, which moved and shrank and eventually became the malleus, the incus, and stapes. So this is the origin of those three tiny bones that are so important to mammalian theory.
I think you'll agree with me that if you resort to flick books, you're not really proving your point. And I don't think we should go by conjecture. We should go by evidence. And the Bible does say the hearing ear and the seeing eye, the Lord has made even both of them. I frankly see that that is verified by the science. Interestingly, the Lord quotes in Matthew 11 to John the Baptist, the blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. Some of the miracles that the Lord did were to do with the deaf and the dumb. And he would speak to them, and immediately he would heal them. This raises another issue. Not only do we have physical ears, but we actually need to listen spiritually to his voice. Everyone, it says in John 18, that is of the truth, hears my voice. And I'd like to ask you, as I end, are you hearing the voice of God? There is coming a day in John 5, 28 and 29, where it says that all will hear the voice of God. Let me just read it to you. It says in John 5, these immortal words, and they're very strong words, and may I just encourage you not to close your ears to the Lord Jesus speaking to you today. Because he is speaking through the creation, but he's also telling us through the Bible the importance of listening to his voice. John 5, 28 and 29 says this, marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice and shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. It's very important, all of you, that you listen to the voice of God. Jesus Christ is the creator, but the greatest thing that Jesus did for us is when he died on the cross to take our guilt. And the Bible is speaking to us today about turning to the Lord Jesus, not only as our creator, but as our redeemer. And may I encourage you not to close your ears to the voice of God. He has spoken. He has spoken also not only about creation, but about redemption. And that's even more important. That's why we as a creation community strongly advocate that we do not shift our creation, because it's connected with believing in the Bible when it speaks about redemption. And remind you, as I said earlier, there is coming a day when literally you will hear the voice of God. On which side of Christ will you be there? You need to trust the Lord Jesus Christ and receive him as your own Savior. It's not just believing in creation, really, which is the important thing. What's important is believing in Christ as the Savior. If you want to know more of that, I've got a booklet which I only give to people who come and inquire with me about that. You are welcome to do so. I have it with me, but I'm not putting it on the bookstore. You have to come and ask me for it if you want help about becoming a Christian. Questions? Feel free to ask them. Yes, sir.
I find that this whole lecture tonight has caused me to want to worship.
That's what it's worship. That's right.
Now, another question, many
things. Can I just comment on that first?
Yes.
He said, if you all heard him, this causes us to worship. That's no glory to me. I'm just a mouthpiece, right? Yes. But that's what I'm aiming at. I'm always aiming not that the glory be to me, but the glory be to Christ in all my talks. But I guess this one has so much which immediately, if we're really walking with the Lord, does show us the glory of Christ. And I love it when people say that. Right, good question.
A medical question.
Yeah, go ahead.
One of the wonders to me would be an eye, ear, and nose surgeon who has to go into the inner ear and do an operation on either one of these tiny little items, the malleus or the incus, because one of them has snapped. How could they repair?
Thank you for mentioning that.
That small, and it's always vibrating.
I was running out of time, and I didn't want to hold you here all night. There were things that I've missed out. One of them, but I'll bring it up now in the question time. One of them is this issue of surgeons which have done marvelous operations, and did they do it by accident? By golly, they didn't. They actually did it by very precise engineering. The operation I'm thinking of is the cochlear implant operation. It was started by Professor Graham Clark from Melbourne University, and I actually sent him a copy of this talk through a patient who had been one of the first to receive a cochlear implant from him. He and his wife both couldn't hear properly. One of them, I think it was the wife, was totally deaf. And I was in Sydney, was I in Sydney or Melbourne? I can't remember. Anyway, Sydney, I think. And they had the operation from him. Anyway, he marvelously pioneered this operation. I think he had about 10 tiny little wires connected to a microphone here, right, which bypassed the cochlear and were attached to the spiral ganglion nerve, say for 10,000 cycles per second, let's say 2,500 and whatever, you know, so a range. Okay, that may enable them to hear. Then others came along and said, we could do it for a bit more, you know, maybe 20, 30. And I believe now it's got to the figure of thousands of tiny little wires, right? Very precisely attached to the spiral ganglion nerve. This is wonderful. So people are going around saying, I can now hear the music. And when they were born totally deaf, in other words, they got the color to sound. Remember I said, that harmony is the color, like light has color. So, yes, I'm sure it's true for eyes. You mentioned, what was it, nose and other things. So, yes, these surgeons, if they're really honest, have to admit that the system is absolutely spectacular in its engineering. Sadly, some of them are not the Lord's. In fact, most of them perhaps are not, I don't know. But I'm not a surgeon, but I'd love to talk with some of them and actually hear what they've done, because it really is giving glory to God. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
So thank you much for your talk. You mentioned how the over design of the ear is like purposeful, like the show's
beauty.
Like a tiger, nations, and talking.
Well, you've touched on it at the end. You've answered your own question, because the issue is survival. Whistling in the wind is not going to add to your survival capability. Certainly not on its own, it's not going to be, right? The fact that I might be able to whistle to my mate and say, hey, watch out, you're going to, you know, you're falling over a cliff or you're going into a dangerous situation. You need a number of things to be working together to make any argument for this possibly being an advantage. Having extra frequencies, and not just the high frequencies, but all the frequencies in between. What I was saying adds to beauty is specifically the fine tuning of those frequencies in between the two major frequencies. So we're now picking up sufficient frequencies to make harmony, right? And so that is an argument, if you like, it's the redundancy argument. You only usually have redundancy when it's a mark of mind and engineering behind it. If it's a matter of survival, you're not going to argue for redundancy. In a sense, this is another way of putting it. Redundancy is saying, well, it's not really that much use, but it's there for some reason. I'm saying the reason is beauty. No, I'm not particularly saying that. I'm saying that there is no particular value of anything being an advantage in this redundant system anyway, unless a number of things are there. You talked about whistling in the wind, for instance, right? Well, that whistling in the wind has no effect on me in terms of an advantage, unless it's connected with something else where it's communicating to another person, in this case, I would suggest, to make it an advantage for me in an evolutionary context.
You said right now we haven't quite figured out those connections.
No, it's. I think you're missing the point to say we haven't figured out, because we do know what it's there for. We know that we appreciate beauty. There is no particular reason for these other frequencies other than we have very finely tuned ears for communication, speech, and for music. So we don't need them for just simple communication. And the simple communication could be argued has gone to a more complicated communication, if that's the way you're going to argue in evolutionary terms. But it seems to be really an argument far more for the technology that was there to begin with, because speech has always been with us. It's a mark of humanity. There's more in this than just the argument of beauty. It is also the argument of communication and the fact that we have the ability not only to communicate technology, but also to communicate it to the next generation. So it's part of a much wider argument. But thank you for the point. It's another, any other points, questions, statements, disagreements? I welcome them. Try to be fair to those who may be of a different view as well. And there may be others who take a different view. I'll just repeat while you're thinking, and we'll close in a moment, but running through this was the principle of, remember what I said, irreducible complexity. Those bones will not work without the ligaments. Those bones will not work unless they're the right shape. If you don't have the cochlea into which the stirrup is going, there's no point in having the bones, right? So everything has to be there for a functioning ear system. It's a very, very good example of irreducible complexity. So remember this, the argument is not, oh, given enough time, we'll find a reason why we got all this, right? That doesn't work with this, because by definition, irreducible complexity says that it's a matter of everything being there in order to work. We get this in aircraft, right? It's no use just having two wings because you need a tailplane as well. You'll never control the aircraft. And even if you've got two wings at the back, two wings at the front, you need ailerons to control it and all the rest of it, right? So irreducible complexity is a very important argument in this matter of the creation evolution debate, and it's never properly been dealt with by the evolutionary community. They've never properly addressed the issue of irreducible complexity. But there's yet another level, which I'll just say is this. There is an information system which is controlling the irreducible complex machinery. And that is in the DNA, which is actually controlling the growth of the ear, of a human ear, controlling the growth of a dog ear, and so on. One last question to end with, or are we done? Shall we hand over back over to Brad then? Do you want to pray, or do you want to,
yes.
Yeah. Want to make some announcements?
All right. Thank you everyone for coming out tonight. See you guys there. Thank you, Dr. Annie McIntosh. Can we give Dr. Annie McIntosh a round of applause? Not glorifying him, as he said, but thanking him for his work and his study in this field. I'll say a prayer don't be afraid to stay around, ask questions, ask Dr. Annie McIntosh for his book, or go buy a book for yourself. All right. Dear God, thank you for the day. Thank you for this evening of intellectual, but also spiritual smartening just teaching. We rely on you for just the design and the purpose in our lives. And I think this tonight has been a really good reflection of your purpose in the design of our ears, to be listening and to be attentive to you and your voice. So just pray that you would speak to every one of us as we go into our lives and our busy lives, but help us remember this night and what it means and everything you've imparted to us. In your name I pray, amen.